British Triathlon, proudly partnered by GE. Imagination at work.
Hello from the Strathclyde Country Park. For most of the year, this quiet part of North Lanarkshire is a place where people come to enjoy the open spaces and woodlands, a bit of water sports or walking. But this weekend, it's turned over to some more energetic visitors and the cut and thrust of top class competition as the GE Strathclyde Park Triathlon is back. Triathlon is a high growth and high tech, and as we saw recently in London, a high performing Olympic sport in which Britain leads the way. In Hyde Park, of course, the Brownlee brothers won Britain's first triathlon Olympic medals. The first major UK competition to take place after those triumphant games is here this weekend, and this event has a little something for everyone. The motto of the London Olympics was to inspire a generation. And in triathlon, that really counts for all generations. The age group event is open to all comers of all abilities. For those inspired by Johnny and Alistair into competing in their first ever triathlon, to those in the running for age group medals. Paratriathlon will be included into the Paralympics in 2016 in Rio, and we have some of the best British athletes here today. With the 2012 Olympics and Paralympics done and dusted, many British athletes' focus will turn to the next major championships to take place on these shores, the 2014 Commonwealth Games, whose triathlon will take place right here in the Strathclyde Country Park. For some athletes, this is a vital opportunity to check out the venue and suss out the competition, as we have world and European champions as part of the elite GB team, here to take on round four of the British Triathlon Super Series. Patrick Winston is your race commentator today, and before the action gets started, let's join him for a look back at the series so far.
This year's Super Series started at Blenheim Palace, an event with spectacular backdrops and vehicle-free roads, dominated over the past years by Jodie Stimpson, and nothing changed. She was in fine form to win the women's event. Mass participation, very much the name of the game at Blenheim, but there were two men in particular that the crowds were interested in, the Brownlee brothers. Alistair back in action after a long period of rehabilitation. Would his Achilles tendon survive the race? And which one of the two brothers would come out on top? Well, it was Alistair who was first out of the water, but he was soon to be joined by Johnny, and those two shared the lead throughout the bike ride. Looking on very, very good form before, of course, the Olympic Games.
Second, too good, aren't they?
Harry Wiltshire resigned to defeat in the early stages. Well, the Brownlees continued to dominate, high cadence, high speed, and they were to cross the line together once again. A fine performance by them, and then it was on to Windsor. Tim Dodd was the man who was on form here in a duathlon because of the high water levels in the Thames. He looked very, very strong. In the women's, Jackie Slack winning again in Windsor, and she looked very strong on the final run. From the towers of Windsor Castle, it was on to the towering buildings of Canary Wharf for a sprint event. Big crowds, big names, and a big bunch of Aussies to compete with. Ashley Bailey and the rest of the Aussies looking very strong through the heat. Must have been thinking in terms of victory in London, but it was the duathlon world champion, Katie Hewison, to continue her rise in the world of triathlon. A brilliant win. There were plenty of nations represented in the men's event as well, a strong field, but it was three men from three nations leading into the home straight. Royal of Australia up against Jared Shoemaker of USA. They out-sprinted Aaron Harris of Great Britain. Royal the stronger over the last 100 metres. A fine performance. And the Australians continuing a good record in London. Tim Don sprinting into fourth to maintain his lead in the Super Series. And so on to Strathclyde, where for the second time this season we have a duathlon instead of a triathlon. Too much rainfall causing problems. Tim Don leads the way in the series ahead of Richard Stannard, who will be in the commentary box with me today, saving his efforts for London. In the women's event, well, it's Sophie Caldwell of England in third with 160, just ahead of her, Kate Robson. But it's Emily McLaughlin of Wales who leads the way with two to go.
Yeah, it does feel good. I'm hoping to get a good finish, like position in this race, so I can improve on my race from Canary Wharf and get a high placing to get a few more points. We've got another big international field, so it's going to be pretty tough too.
Well, with me this weekend is Annie Emerson. Now, Annie, the series is hotting up. There's a lot to play for with this race.
Yeah, there certainly is. We've had three races down. We've got two to go. We don't really have a standout favourite at the moment, but Katie Hewison is racing. She raced really well in Canary Wharf. So we could see another win from her, which will certainly put her in a great place going into London, the final race.
Now, just to throw the cat amongst the pigeons, this is going to be a duathlon. So a run, bike, run, as opposed to a swim, bike, run.
Yeah, that does change things slightly. It certainly does. And it will obviously favour the weaker swimmer and stronger runners. And I think for the likes of Katie Hewison, who is a world duathlon champion, she's going to be quite pleased with that. Brian Keane from Ireland, also an ex-pro cyclist and a very good runner, he'll be quite pleased that he's not going to have to swim as well.
Now, you're actually a former World Series winner in duathlon. What are the difference in tactics? Because you don't normally, as a triathlete, train biking off a hard run.
The run will take your heart rate up quite a bit higher than it will in the swim. So you're coming into the bike really with the heart rate really high. And even though it's a 1.3 kilometre run, which is technically pretty short, the athletes are going to be quite knackered going out onto the bike.
We have a little bit of an Ashes battle going on here. The Australians have brought a very strong team.
They have. In the men's race, Brendan Sexton, who is a former World Cup winner, will, I think, give the guys a lot of competition. And also in the women's race, they've brought in a few of their junior athletes that are very strong. Charlotte McShane, who's actually originally from Scotland, had a terrible transition in Canary Wharf, but we know she's very strong and strong on the run. So I think that we're going to be seeing the Australians playing a big part in the race.
Well, the elite race will be underway shortly, but first, here's Patrick with a roundup of the other events that have been going on here at Strathclyde Park.
We've got a really good entry for all the age group competitions here in Strathclyde. Now, it's a vital race. Not only is it the Scottish National Championships, it's also a qualifying race for the European Age Group Championships next year in Turkey. And that's why we've got such an eager-looking field, including Jessica Jocelyn, who gave birth to a baby daughter just 4.5 months ago.
I was in the gym that morning and I swam with my swimming squad all the way through as well, so I kind of got a few strange looks. I think the last month my coach was a bit concerned that I was going to drop any minute, but I just kept going and kept going back, and he never told me to get out of the water. So.
Living in Dubai, so I've just literally come back for 2 days to try and qualify for the Euros next year. It's my second race back after a little while out, and yeah, fingers crossed.
I've got a very supportive husband, I have to say. So he kind of looks after Holly before he goes to work in the morning, and I go out training for a few hours. And then, yeah, generally go and sort of sit on the turbo trainer in the evening as well, after he's come back from work with babies in bed.
The age group races in triathlon have proved hugely popular over the years, and there's absolutely no need to stop competing once you've got the bus pass.
Very privileged to be speaking to, perhaps, we think, the oldest lady in the race.
Absolutely great to be here. Hoping to qualify for Turkey next year in the Europeans. So, yeah, really looking forward. I think triathlon's a lovely balanced sport. And I'm actually getting into enjoying swimming just a bit as I aim for Ironman next year. I'm keen to do anything I can to get other older people into sport. I mean, I think it's given me so much. Fun, fitness, stability, confidence, all of those sorts of words that go across the rest of your life. So absolutely committed to getting as many people over the age of 50 into more serious sport and exercise.
There's a para-triathlon competition here as well in Strathclyde. Jane Egan, world champion and the British para-triathlete of the year last year. Adrian Heathfield is here as well, a man who's astonished everyone with the speed that he's got up and running after his operation.
It's my first year as in paratri, so I'm only 10 months post-op, so yeah, it was good. I'm really happy with the time and that, so it's good to kind of to kind of get more interest in the para tri as well, doing something like this. And with it being in the Olympics in 2016 as well, it's going to highlight it all, and hopefully we'll get a lot more people involved.
Well, I'm sure that will be the case, and especially after the fantastic coverage of the Paralympics in London, there's no doubt this sport is going to get more and more popular.
That was good fun. I enjoyed it. It's a nice hilly bike ride. I like that.
And the fact that it's in the programme for Rio 2016, is that playing in your mind?
Yeah, I might be a bit old for it by then, but hopefully I'll provide a bit of competition for the people to come in. I think there's going to be a lot more people coming into the sport now it's in the Paralympic programme, so there should be a lot more competition coming up in the next few years.
Jessica Jocelyn's time in the age group is 2:17.56. Still a little race rusty, but that's understandable.
The bike was really tough. I knew it was going to be quite a technical course because it was quite a lot of short hills in there. And then I kind of got off the bike and my legs just took ages and they just settled into the run.
Congratulations, you happy with that?
I'm absolutely thrilled. I finished, I qualified for Turkey. Yeah, no, this is the first time I've run a duathlon or a triathlon since I was told not to run again, so I'm really pleased.
This event speeds on and it's time to hand the course over to the elite athletes. Let's find out which of the women are going to get into top gear today.
Well, there's no doubt that after her success at Canary Wharf, all eyes will be on Katie Hewison, the duathlon world champion, but she's not had the best of preparation.
Oh, I've had an epic journey. We basically went to a wedding last night for a very good friend and a British triathlon coach, Rick Vallette, over in Swansea. So I don't think I could have gone anywhere further away. And then, yeah, made the huge journey across, which I've got my husband to thank for. I very nicely slept all the way up. And then, yes, very sadly, we ran out of petrol 5 miles to go on the motorway. So it's been an eventful journey so far.
Well, there's no doubt that the duathlon format will suit Katie Hewison despite those problems that she's had. Here are the details of today's course. The 1,300-metre run gets it underway instead of a swim. A 20-kilometre bike ride. It's a technical ride and very tricky indeed. And then a fast, flat 5-kilometre run to finish it off. And that is so often where the race is decided.
Obviously, duathlon will play to my strength. You know, that's what I'm best at. But either way, I genuinely wasn't bothered if it was a triathlon or a duathlon, because the idea of me racing today is to get some good preparation ready for the World Duathlons in 3 weeks. So my race tactics will be to go out and have a really solid bike to run. So whether it's a swim at the start or a run at the start, I will still be doing the exact same tactics. I'm just excited to race and give it a good bash.
Now, although you may not believe it when you hear the accent, Charlotte McShane is about as close as we get to a local, having been born in Scotland.
I actually went to school in Glasgow and grew up doing triathlons around this area and running around this area, and a lot of my family and friends still live around Strathclyde, so it's great to come back, and this is the second time I've been back since moving to Australia 6 years ago. So it's nice to see everyone. It'll be pretty tough. There's a lot of really good girls in here, so it's not going to be easy.
Well, two of those good girls are Grace Musgrove and, of course, Ashley Bailey, who is one of the favourites and will certainly enjoy racing amongst her compatriots.
All us three Aussies, we train together, so we know each other's strengths and each other's weakness. So definitely in a race, it's quite cool to race each other because you know where you can get the other one and if the other one's feeling good. But we're very competitive amongst ourselves, so it's quite fun. Feeling pretty pumped. It's going to be a good race, and I'm looking forward to doing a different setup for it, so duathlon, so it'd be interesting.
Now, the first run leg of this race is going to be hard enough. Well, some athletes have made it even harder on themselves by incurring a penalty before it even starts. Let's join Patrick to find out more.
Well, that penalty is 10 seconds, and the interesting fact is that it's been imposed on a number of the favourites in this race at Strathclyde, so there'll be some tactical changes involved. Now, here's the list of favourites in the women's event, and Katie Hewison, Ashley Bailey, Grace Musgrove, Georgia Taylor-Brown have all incurred this 10-second penalty. Charlotte McShane has got away with it, so she's in a very strong position, and she will start in the first group. 1.3 kilometres the distance of the first run instead of the swim.
And although you're not going to win it in this first phase, if you work too hard, you can certainly throw away your chances. So away go the early starters. Alongside me, Richard Stannard, one of the best swimmers in triathlon. He would have been disappointed not to have had the swim today. And what would you do, firstly, Richard, if you're in the chasing group, starting 10 seconds behind, and if you were like Charlotte Lachaine, privileged enough to get a head start?
Well, I'd certainly be disappointed to be 10 seconds down. And I think Kate Hewerson has looked at the other athletes in this pack and will make a decision on whether or not they're strong enough to catch up on the bike. I don't think they're going to try and do it on this run. I think they'll wait until the bike section.
Well, it's going to be very interesting to see. And it'll be interesting to see whether the likes of Campbell and McShane push the pace early on. McShane, of course, who was born in Scotland.
I think the run will pretty much stay quite close together. I guess I won't be able to make a decision whether I can go, whether I stick in my comfort zone in that first run, but I don't think it'll have a huge effect.
One of the other Australians that we'll be watching out for, Ashley Bailey, on the right of your screen, silver medal at the Junior World Championships last year.
The first run, I think that's going to be pretty fast, isn't it?
Yeah, it's going to be very fast. It'll be interesting to see if any of the girls would take it on and try and get away in that short distance.
I'm going to try and just kind of save a little bit. I'm going to sit in. It's a very short run, so I don't think people are going to get too far away anyway. And then I want to really have a solid bike and a solid run off the bike.
So those two big names in the chasing group. One of the other internationals up front is Lauren Campbell, the Canadian national champion. And she's settling in fourth place at the moment.
I plan on staying on till the London Triathlon, so I've based myself in Glasgow for the next 3 weeks. I did win my first World Cup ever this year back home in Canada in Edmonton, and it was also Canadian Championship, so it was a pretty special win for me.
So a pretty talented field all round. Richard, the race developing pretty much as you thought it would.
Yeah, I think the girls are taking it relatively steady and are going to try and catch back up on the bike, whereas the front pack should be working very hard. They've got this lead, they need to capitalise on it, and I don't think they're the strongest bikers, so they need to make use of this first 1.3k, get as big a gap as they can, and then try and hold on to that working together on the bike to stay away from these chasers.
And I wonder how difficult it is to change your plans, because of course this was billed as a triathlon, but because of the water conditions here in Strathclyde, they've had to change it to a duathlon. And for those swimmers, it must be difficult to have a positive frame of mind.
It's very difficult. We've had an interesting summer with the weather we've had, and this is the second race in the series that's been changed to a duathlon, and I was in the first race, and you just change your mindset, you realise it's the same for everyone, and you focus on that first run. Damage limitation, get yourself onto the bike, and once you're on the bike, it's like a normal triathlon. You've just got to run a solid run off the bike.
Katie Hewerson certainly won't be upset as they come into the transition onto the bike for the first time. 1.3 kilometres completed, just over 4 minutes for those early runners. Pallant has had a fantastic run, and Bamford also a very, very impressive performance early on. There's Campbell of Canada, needs to get on the bike and away and take full advantage of the fact that they've actually extended their lead over the chasers who are coming into transition now. Hewerson on the near side. Through the regular drills. No mistakes from her.
That was a good transition. They're going to try and get themselves into a small pack, work together to catch the leaders. They don't want to rush it, put themselves in the red zone too early. Catching them midway through the bike will give them a perfect opportunity to recover before the second run.
Well, 26 seconds is the margin that they're trying to close down. 20 kilometres the distance on the bike today. And we'll find out after the break how they get on.
British Triathlon, proudly partnered by GE. Imagination at work.
Welcome back to the GE Strathclyde Park Triathlon. After controversy that saw some of the top athletes delayed for 10 seconds at the start, it was an interesting run, but now they're on the bike, there's all to play for. 20 kilometres of riding ahead of them. Let's rejoin Patrick Winterton with the commentary.
Well, the elite performers are starting to show their strengths here at Strathclyde. We've got a leading group of four. McShane, McPhee, Bamford. Bamford had an excellent run over that 1.3 kilometres, but leading the way in the red and white, it's Canada's Campbell, who looks very, very strong, a woman who started her career as a swimmer.
I was out here training yesterday, and I quite like the course. It's technical, it's got a few hills, so it should be a good challenge.
Well, we'll see how Campbell gets on. 18 months off from injury. It's nice to see her back in the race. In the second group, Katie Hewison, it is doing much of the work up front, and she'll be pushing very, very hard. The world duathlon champion, looking good.
I've not raced here before, so it'll be exciting to race. I do like the hills. I think there's a few undulations. So, again, we'll see what happens. I think there's an opportunity for a small group to maybe get away on this type of course. It's an out and back.
She certainly does like the hills. Former mountain running champion Katie Hewison, and she's got Ashley Bailey for company. These two working so hard that they're starting to split the chasers. Richard, impressed by those two?
Absolutely. I think this is exactly what they need to do. Four of the girls up up the front need to be closed down, but two of them trying to close it down, Bailey and Hewison. It's not going to be easy, but they can see them with this out and back course, and that should give them some hope.
Well, they were 26 seconds behind. They're now just 15 seconds behind. So an 11-second gain on the bike already. That's a really good move by Hewison and Bailey in particular. And Hewison has to hang on to the Australian here.
Certainly, she's going to have to work very, very hard to ensure that she can get herself back up to the lead group. They can see them there just going round the corner. And once you've got the athletes in sight, it makes it that much easier to try and close the gap. If they're out of sight, they're almost out of mind.
McShane just taking her turn at the front to give Lauren Campbell a little bit of a rest, but the Canadian keen to push the pace, and she's working well here at Strathclyde. The conditions a little warmer than many of the international athletes were expecting. The Australians certainly won't be complaining as they come towards the end of the first lap. Four laps of 5 kilometres, and it's a technical ride as well. I know one or two athletes have had problems in the past.
Certainly that corner there we see is very tight. It's off camber, sharp right-hander off camber. You've really got to get your outside leg down and get the weight onto the outside leg to ensure you get round that corner. And that then leads down towards transition, which again is technical. You've got different surfaces going from the tarmac onto the carpet, and there are lots of tight turns as well.
So technical, in fact, that even the Australians have checked out the course.
Very undulating on the ride, and when you come back through transition there is actually some tight corners, so I have to take it pretty safe on the wet, so it'll be interesting to see.
So through the transition area for the first time, and Ashley Bailey certainly has seen the leading group, and she's not going to ease up here. I think Katie Hewison showing a lack of experience on the bike, not so aggressive on the corners, but that may be a good thing.
No, you're absolutely right. She's not smooth through those corners, not really getting the weight onto the outside leg. You actually want to come slightly forward on the saddle, or even raise your bum slightly off the saddle to ensure that the weight is down that outside leg. That then gives the bike balance as you go around the corner. And if you want to take it even further, you can put a little bit of weight on your inside arm to give it some counter steer. And that then throws the bike around the corner and ensures that you can hold the wheel of the person in front. It's a skill that you need to practice. And certainly in these shorter, sharper races, it's absolutely crucial to get the cornering correct.
Well, here we have the catch as Ashley Bailey comes up alongside McPhee, who's been in the leading four for so much of the race. Now is going to find that she's got to up her level if she wants to stay with the leaders, but it doesn't look as though she's responded. Hewison and Bailey have gone straight through. Now, I wonder whether they'll do the same to the leading three. What would your tactics be here?
Well, I think Katie Hewison knows she's now at the front of the race. She's going to be very confident in her ability to win from this position. So I don't think she's going to want to work any harder than she has to. She'll probably sit in this pack, take it nice and steady and wait for that second 5K run. It's flat, it's fast. I don't believe there's any reason for her to really make any more effort than she already has.
And watch out for Lauren Campbell of Canada in the red and white as well. So an interesting situation developing here in Strathclyde. And remember, they still have 12 kilometres on the bike to go before they switch to feet for the final time with a 5 kilometre run to finish off. Ashley Bailey leading the way, and her fellow Australian McShane is in that leading group as well. Bamford's done exceptionally well to hang on to the back of this group, but Katie Hewison and Lauren Campbell will fancy their chances as they come towards the end of the bike ride. Lauren Campbell looking confident and an excellent runner. approaching T2, the switch from bike to run, a transition that they're all very, very familiar with. And the same group of five off the bike before the line, absolutely crucial to avoid picking up any penalties.
Okay, here we have Ashley Bailey from Australia.
Bamford at the back of that group of five. She's a good runner. She proved that in the first 1.3 kilometres. But I wonder how much that bike ride has taken out of her. Ashley Bailey through the drills. On with the left shoe for Katie Hewison, and she's away. Now, this is all about determination, how much they want to win it, and how on earth they think they're going to hold off Katie Hewison, who already looks full of running.
Now, Hewison had an excellent transition there, went in fourth, out in second. Bailey and Bamford, however, got it all wrong. They had their trainers on the other side of their bike than their box, so they took the helmets off into the box, then had to run around their bike and put their trainers on. They need to think about that, which side of the bike they come into transition on next time.
Valuable seconds thrown away. Georgia Taylor-Brown, who started the race well, lost a little ground on the bike, needs to make it up again on this final phase, but she has no chance of catching these two. Lauren Campbell actually running very strongly, looking smooth.
Very smooth indeed, and the gap is now growing. What looked like a small gap out of T2 can quickly grow, and it's looking at about a 10-second gap at the moment. And ominously, Katie Hewison on the shoulder of Campbell there looks even more comfortable.
Now, there's one big change from the initial 1.3-kilometre run, and that is that the course is absolutely flat, so the time should be fast. We're looking for anything between 16, 17 minutes for the leading two women. They're both capable of times around there. The question is, which one of the two is going to produce the faster time? A little bit of wind to think about on the way round, maybe. Tuck in behind the opposition.
Yeah, it's very useful to have an athlete to run with. You can sit in on the shoulder and save valuable energy and then make your move when the time is right.
Modern sport all about looking for those half percentages here and there. This is an opportunity for the leaders to see where the opposition are, and Katie Hewison has decided it is time to go. A definite upping of the pace, and now we'll see whether Lauren Campbell can respond.
Absolutely, the stride length increased there. Katie Hewison lengthened her stride, and Campbell's stride length is much shorter, and therefore she's got to get a cadence, a leg speed up to try and hold on to this gap that's beginning to form. And I think we're going to see Katie Hewison pull away.
Well, you're absolutely spot on. Campbell still running well, but the length of stride, the knees coming a little bit higher, and this is just what Hewison managed to do at the sprint event in London earlier on this season. On this sort of form, she is certainly going to be in a good position to defend her world title in the Duathlon Championships on the 22nd of September. Through the halfway stage of the run, one lap completed, one to go, and already Hewison has a gap of some 30 metres. Bailey of Australia down in third, but not running as smoothly as the two leaders. Has she got anything left in the tank? The gazelle-like style of Katie Hewison must be depressing for the rest of the athletes. From elite runner, she is very much an elite duathlete now, and it won't be long before she joins the very best in the world in triathlon. Into the finish area, celebrations start with 100 metres to go, and Katie Hewison adds another title to her increasing list. A very, very impressive performance when you bear in mind she started 10 seconds behind the bulk of the athletes here today. Excellent.
And here comes our second place athlete from Canada.
Big smiles from Hewison. Lauren Campbell, well beaten on the day. She cycled well, stuck with the leading group of five, and managed to hold on to Hewison for the bulk of the first lap. But the Canadian found wanting over the last 2.5 Ks. The Australians came in numbers, and Ashley Bailey proving to be the best on the day. Third place, all she can manage. Just over a minute behind today's winner. She's got a lot of potential. Katie Hewison, second in Stockholm last weekend. She takes the win today.
Myself and Ashley worked really hard together on the bike to close that gap.
So yeah, it was really good teamwork, and then we did get a good group working together at the front, which enabled us to grow a healthy lead on the other group behind. So it was a really good team effort, and yeah, a tough, challenging course. I just wanted to have a really solid bike to run and make sure I stayed upright this time, and yeah, get a bit of confidence from that today to take into the World Championships.
Actually, you went into the start of the race with a 10-second penalty, which wasn't a great way to start the race, but you managed to make that front, Pat. You must have worked pretty hard on that first run.
Yeah, Katie and it wasn't really the run we worked hard on, it was the bike. I mean, the minute we got on the bike, we still had that 10 seconds, so we hadn't made up anything. So it was just the hammer down was from the start, yeah.
Third pace finish, you must be really happy.
Yeah, I loved it here. It was a great experience. So much fun.
And not too far behind the first place finisher, Katie Hewison. She's the current world duathlon champion. So actually, you did pretty well to stay in touch.
Yeah, I'm pretty happy. I mean, she's an incredible runner, and I knew she was the one to beat today. So to be even in touch with her, even on that first lap, I'm pretty pleased with that.
Next stop, London, right?
London is next, yeah.
And we'll look forward to seeing Campbell in London. Hewison it is who takes the win ahead of Campbell and Bailey. Charlotte McShane gives the locals a little bit of cheer. Of course, she was born in Scotland, spent much of her time in Helensburgh. And Emma Pallant with the fastest run of the day will take cheer from that. Katie Hewison with two wins this season tops the standings in the Super Series with just one event to go. Only 40 points separating the top positions. The men's event still to come here in Strathclyde. We've got a big field of 55 elite athletes looking for glory.
British Triathlon, proudly partnered by GE. Imagination at work.
Welcome back to the GE Strathclyde Park Triathlon. The women have already run, and Katie Hewison of Great Britain taking victory in fine style ahead of Campbell of Canada, and Australia's Ashley Bailey coming through to take third place. Now the Australians will be expecting something a little better in the men, because they've got Brendan Sexton going, a man who we've seen race in London, and of course he was part of the Olympic Games as well.
Scotland's a long way from Australia, but we spend a lot of the European summer in Europe anyway, so I've done a lot of the GE British races before. They're always really well run with really good competition, so I thought I'd give this a go after racing in London 3 weeks ago. It's a really nice course, so it'll be good with the other guys out there. I'd love to win today, but I mean, with the competition here, a podium, I'd be very happy with just getting on the podium.
Well, the Aussies are here and the Irish are here as well. It's great to see Brian Keane back in action, a man who's had more than his fair share of injury.
And the athletes have been talking about that first run. Some have been saying, oh, we're going to sit in and save energy, and others are going to be saying, no way, you know, we're going to take that out pretty hard. What are your thoughts?
Somebody's going to take it on. I'm not going to take it on, but somebody will, and everyone will curse them. It's a very short race. It's short and fast, and you see what happens. You race what happens, and I can see somebody taking their chances, having a go, but it's so short, 1300 metres. You know, you're going to gain nothing from it, even if you run really hard. There's very little to be gained.
Well, Brendan Sexton said it was a high quality field. It certainly is. We've got the under 23 world champion, Matt Sharp.
Yeah, well, I progressed on really nicely in the winter, but then I got a bit of fatigue syndrome and had a few problems and issues, but I'm back now, I'm healthy again, and yeah, it'll be fun to be racing again. There's quite a lot of younger guys in the field as well, so I'm guessing that the first run's going to be absolutely flat out, and then just try and have a good transition and work your way back in. Dave McNamee, he's definitely going well, and I think Richie Nicholls and Brendan Sexton, their form's a bit unknown, but they're definitely the stronger athletes in the field.
Well, this is the man the locals will be supporting, 24-year-old from Irvine. It's Dave McNamee, who took the silver medal in Beijing at the Under-23 World Champs.
I raced in Strathclyde in 2010, where I was second behind Richie, who won that day. So, yeah, hopefully I get on that podium again. He's a phenomenal talent. His running is sort of one of the best in the sport. And now that it's a duathlon, it's going to, you know, suit him down to the ground. So, yeah, I think Richie's the one to watch.
He certainly is. He won this event in 2010, and he's back to win it again in 2012.
Just see how it goes. And there's a lot of good athletes here, so yeah, just try my best, and hopefully it'll be good enough. The start of the first run, it's going to be intense, and there's a few corners right at the start of the first run, so it's going to be important to get away and right at the start. So it's a start thing. It's not the end of the world if you're 5 seconds back, but it'd be good, you know, it'd be good to be near the front anyway.
Now, just seconds to go before the start of the race, and we have a very similar situation to the women's race. Almost half the field have been penalised by 10 seconds. It's going to make for a very interesting initial run. Let's join Patrick for the commentary.
Well, these are the men who've incurred a 10-second penalty. Let's see those names in red. Matt Sharp, Nichols, Keane. You'll notice at the top that McNamee and Sexton have got away with it. And they're two very strong runners. They start in the front group. An opportunity, maybe, for them to take an advantage.
Well, I think with the second pack being so strong as it is, and the majority of the better athletes being in the second pack, I think they will end up working together on the bike. They'll probably take it easy on this run, wait for the bike ride, as we saw in the women's race, work themselves through throughout the course of the bike, saving something for the run.
They've got 1,500 metres. Remember, the first phase of this race, instead of the swim, is a 1.3-kilometre run. It's not a long enough run to gain much of a lead. It's certainly long enough to build some lactate in the legs if you work too hard.
Well, it looks like Brendan Sexton has taken this one out quite hard, but he could be just trying to keep himself out of trouble.
I think the run, it's really quite short for what we're used to. We're normally 5 or 10k, so I think it'll be really fast, and with the hill in it, it might really hurt some people. I know that I'm not really looking forward to running up a hill that at a faster pace than I'm used to, but yes, it might break apart a little bit, and then might be some gaps open up on the bike.
Sexton obviously out to enjoy himself today. There he is in the middle of that group at the front, and it's a stiff pace set by the leaders. The chase group, well, no sign of Richie Nichols so far, and as I speak, he works his way through on the far side. Very, very smooth running style. And although he's a good swimmer, I think he'll benefit from the fact that there hasn't been a swim today.
Absolutely. He's in great running shape, and you cannot overlook him in the duathlon. He's a class act.
Another man we want to watch out for is Dave McNamee, who knows this course very, very well.
I think a lot of people, once you get to the top of the hill after 500-600 metres, might be at the lead, but they're going to suffer for it. So I think it's all about, even though it's just 1.3k, it's about not being crazy.
Around the turn at the top of the hill, and then they start the descent. Now, it's easy to build some speed here, but it's also easy to do some damage to the legs on the descent.
Yeah, absolutely. The big temptation with 1.3k could be to blast it, and coming down that hill, that could cost and put a bit of lactic acid in the legs going into this bike ride, where you've then got to go back up this hill, and the course is pretty undulating and quite technical with lots of acceleration, so that could lead to an excessive build of lactate. And what we can actually see here is the second group beginning to catch the stragglers of the front group. So that's going to create a nice little ladder, if you like, that the cyclists can work up to catch these leaders.
Greg Turner there in second place, just behind Wade, who has a very distinctive running style, approaching transition number one. As we saw in the women's race, it's easy to throw away a few valuable seconds. Sam Wade running straight past his bike, a classic error, and takes a stumble, so he's lost a little bit of time. Sexton of Australia, hugely experienced, shouldn't make any such mistake. We've got Nichols of Scotland. He's done well. Remember, he started 10 seconds behind Brendan Sexton, so he's had a tremendous run, Richie Nichols. But it's the Australian who leads out onto the bike course. He will not want to go it alone, but he will want to make sure that he's up with the leaders for the first 5K.
Well, I think what we've seen here is that Brendan Sexton and the front group have taken it easy, and the race is really starting now for them. Brendan looking very fast through T1.
The bike is definitely challenging in it with a few different ways. It's quite hilly, it's got some undulations, and down this end towards the transition it is very technical, so that could split up if we get some more skilled cyclists towards the front, really pushing the pace.
Technical course certainly offering opportunities, and one man who knows it very well is Matt Sharp of Great Britain.
I've raced here a number of times before, and I think the bike course is good. It's good to get away because you can get out of sight quite quickly. You only need 5-10 seconds lead and you can kind of get away, so I think it's good.
Big talk from Matt Sharp. I wonder if anyone will try and get away. At the moment, they're just bunching up. 4 laps of 5 kilometres, so they go through the transition area on 3 times before they switch back to the final run. Oh, and that's the first big crash of the day. Austin has gone down. Now he's going to do well to get up and going again, but it looks as though the body and bike have both survived that impact. A little lapse of concentration and a big price to pay on this very technical course here at Strathclyde.
Yeah, the bike course, there's no massive climb, but there's two or three undulations a lap and it can split up. It means that ideally you want to be at the front of the group. You don't want to be trying to chase back on after a technical descent. And then there's a roundabout that goes straight into a nice little drag up. So yeah, it is what you'd call a lumpy bike course. It's definitely not going to be a cruise.
The Green of Ireland hitting the front of the lead group. It's Brian Keane, former professional cyclist. And just behind him, Richie Nicholls.
I think there should be, I hope there'll be a few attempts of the big race on the bike, and I hope I'll be in amongst them. You know, I don't want to just wait for the last run. I'm running well, but I prefer to have a bit of fun on the bike.
And there's a chance that Brian Keane might provide that fun.
Yeah, it's a little lumpy. Again, you'll always get somebody who's trying to take their chance and opportunity on the bike. That's part of racing. It's a question of will they be let go or not.
Well, we'll find out soon enough. And there's no doubt that Brian Keane is the man setting the pace. And it's starting to do some damage. Remember, we had a group of 22, and I think we're down to 7 or 8 riders who are getting away. And this is a key part of this race in Strathclyde. And it's all credit to Brian Keane, who's come back from some really severe injuries. A fractured patella would put most people out of action for good. Brendan Sexton of Australia comes through to do his turn at the front, a man who's impressed Dave McNamee over the years.
But when Brendan's in form, he is one of the best athletes in our sport. I raced against him at Mooloolaba this year, he was fourth. Again, with Brendan, he'll either win it or he could come last. But when he's on form, he is the man to watch.
Well, Sexton certainly put himself in a good position amongst the leaders here as we approach T2. Matt Sharp doing his share at the front and keeping the pace high. We've got Benson in second place coming through. Dave McNamee. Now he wants to get a clean entry into the second transition, and this is absolutely key.
Yeah, it's vital. If you can be the first bike rider into T2, it gives you a very good opportunity to get out onto the run. Now, he needs to steal a march, if he can, on Richie Nicholls, who we know is in sensational running form. And a very fast T2 can really help that.
Looking to see Brian Keane in action over the final run, see how his injuries hold up. McNamee nearest the camera, good drills from him so far. Brendan Sexton with the peroxide hair is away. Richie Nicholls right on his heel. And the top seven get away pretty cleanly. Not a brilliant transition from Matt Sharp. But it's Sexton again who finds himself in the front. He led the first run for a while. He had his turn at the front on the bike. And he finds himself in the lead with just over 4.5 kilometres to go. Brian Keane is there for Ireland as well. And Richie Nicholls starting to make his move.
Yeah, certainly the front four are putting their mark on this race. They look the smoothest of all the runners. And with it being very flat, I think you're going to see these four pull away.
So we've got four racers who will be fighting it out for the podium positions. Matt Sharp just dropping out of the picture at the back. And Richie Nicholls starts to come through. Another man with a distinctive running style, that wide sweeping right hand. But he makes it look easy. It's very, very deceptive. He is travelling incredibly quickly. We're looking for a time of around 15 minutes for the 5Ks.
Yeah, with these dead turns, to break 15 minutes is very hard. And Richie Nicholls certainly has got that opportunity today. He's got the longest stride length out of the front four athletes, and he looks the smoothest right now.
Now, Brian Keane, we've mentioned his injury problems, that right knee, the fractured patella, the kneecap. That certainly won't be easy to cope with. Looks as though he's running in a little bit of pain.
Yeah, he looks to be working very hard there. His stride length is quite short, but rather than it being a knee issue, it actually looks like his hips aren't as flexible as he needs them. Maybe he's been working very hard on his bike ride, get that back in shape, and his hips look quite tight, and therefore he can't open up his legs. But we can see him here pulling into the lead. His cadence is very fast, much faster than that of Richie Nicholls, but it looks like we can see quite a lot of pain on his face, and that could be costing him. He's got such a high cadence, it's going to send his heart rate really high and make his breathing very, very fast.
But these two opening up a little bit of a gap. You can see the pink shoes of Brendan Sexton of Australia in the background. He's sitting in third place at the moment, still running very well. The fashion police might have a word or two to say about his style today. In fourth place, Dave McNamee, who at the moment leads the man who beat him in the under 23 World Championships, Matt Sharp. And McNamee in with a shout of finishing on the podium as Richie Nicholls starts to open the stride again. This time Brian Keane can't respond, and Nicholls looking very, very good as this race gets closer to the climax. Through the transition area again, and as the race goes on, Brian Keane looking more and more like the Olympic walkers, and that's an opportunity for the two men behind him to pounce. Brendan Sexton has taken strength from Brian Keane's discomfort and goes through without any trouble whatsoever. Now McNamee surely will follow as the Irishman begins to fade. Perhaps a pacing problem, or maybe, Richard, the injuries from 2010 starting to catch up.
Yeah, I think you're right there. Brian Keane certainly beginning to suffer with the early pace. Brendan Sexton is now beginning to extend his stride length and pull away from these two athletes.
He might have given the Scotsman a little bit too much of a lead. It's been a consistent pace from Richie Nicholls. Brian Keane suffering now in a battle for third and fourth place with McNamee. Sexton's burst has earned him the silver medal position, but he won't catch Richie Nicholls, who's into the home straight now. Another stellar performance from him. We've seen him win in London in the past, and of course he won here in 2010. He wins again in 2012, confirming his form. Triathlon or duathlon, he is a potential champion, and he's been absolutely outstanding today. Sexton up and down, a good finish on the final run. I wonder where he'll think he could have improved and given himself a shot at the win. McNamee putting two Scots in the top three. That's great for those who've turned out to support today. And Brian Keane, a brave fourth.
Don't come around very often, so when some comes, latest comes along, it's great. I'm really, really happy with the race today. First run was really tough, especially I started 10 seconds back, so I missed the start of the briefing, so it was, I made a really hard first run, and I had to work really hard to start the bike to make sure I was on that pack. Brian Keane of Ireland, he attacked and I went with him, and then half of the pack caught us and half didn't, so that's when it split there. So it was really got to thank Brian there for working hard on the bike. He did a great job.
Yeah, it was definitely tough. It was a bit warmer out there than I actually anticipated. I think I wore a bit too much, but yeah, it was good. The boys worked really hard. I think Richie must have done extra well because he was back in the penalty group 10 seconds behind off the start. So yeah, it was definitely a tough race, and the boys stuck it to me. These races always have good competition, and I always know I'm going to get pushed to my limits when I come here. Richie was incredible today. It was good to see a Scotsman get up in his home country, and David really pushed me near the end there. I was looking over my shoulder for that whole last kilometre once I got a gap. He's a tough competitor, so I knew if he wanted to come back, he'd have a go.
Yeah, I was surprised by how good I felt in the run. Sort of, Richie's a phenomenal runner, and so is Brendan. So just to be up with them, sort of, it's a big boost to the confidence.
And so it should be, but not good enough to beat Richie Nicholls today. 50.33 the winning time, 14.40 for the last 5 kilometres. That is phenomenal. And the 100 points he wins today will put him to the top of the Super Series ahead of Tim Don. And my fellow commentator, Richard Stannard, still in third and still with a chance of winning the series.
Well, we may not have troubled the ducks and the wildlife and the water today, but round four of the British Triathlon Super Series has thrown up a really exciting set of races and built up to the series finale, the London Triathlon. But that's it for this time. Goodbye from the Strathclyde Country Park.
British Triathlon, proudly partnered by GE. Imagination at work.